In the ancient and somber church of Eyam, two elderly gentlemen, seemingly bound together by some strange bond of fate, sat side by side, bickering quietly in the dim light that filtered through the stained glass windows. The older, a stooped figure with a careworn visage, was the Reverend Hunt, the parson of the village. Beside him, the bailiff, a man of equally advanced age and no less severe countenance, stubbornly refused to budge an inch from his seat next to his longtime antagonist. It was a peculiar sight, as peculiar as the story of their lives. Our tale begins decades earlier, when the Reverend Hunt, a young and enthusiastic clergyman, was appointed to the living of Eyam in the waning days of 1683. A fresh-faced man of God, he was eager to shepherd his flock and serve the Lord with all his heart. Alas, the path of life often takes unexpected twists and turns, and such was the case with the young parson. One fateful day in 1684, he was summoned to the Miners' Arms to baptize a sickly infant, the son of the landlord, Mr. Ferns. The child was purportedly too ill to be brought to the church, and so the parson, with a heavy heart and a solemn sense of duty, made his way to the inn. Upon entering the Miners' Arms, the Reverend Hunt was warmly greeted by the inn's patrons, who urged him to partake of their hospitality. Little did he know that the baptism was but a ruse, and the true purpose of his summons was to ply him with more ale than was good for a man of the cloth. Gradually, the parson's inhibitions were swept away in the tide of conviviality, and he found himself paying far too much attention to the landlord's comely daughter, Anne. In the heat of the moment, someone took it upon themselves to join the parson and Anne in matrimony, using the rector's own prayer book to read the marriage service over them. It was a jolly jest to those present, but the following day, the village was in an uproar. The Bishop of Lichfield, none too pleased with the parson's behaviour, delivered a stern rebuke, insisting that the impromptu union be sanctified in the eyes of God and man with a proper ceremony. Thus, on September the 4th, 1684, the Reverend Hunt and Anne were joined in holy matrimony, their union recorded in the parish register. But the parson's troubles were far from over. He had previously proposed marriage to a wealthy lady in Derby, who, upon learning of his new wife, sued him for breach of promise. The ensuing lawsuit drained the young couple's resources and left them destitute. With a bailiff dispatched to arrest them for their mounting debts, the desperate couple sought sanctuary in the church where civil actions could not touch them. The bailiff, a man of great persistence, set up camp at the church gates, and the parson and his wife found themselves confined within the holy walls. In this strange state of limbo, the parson and the bailiff began to form an unlikely, albeit antagonistic, companionship. It was revealed that the woman the parson had jilted was once wooed by the bailiff himself, who had nearly won her heart until the parson's proposal. In a cruel twist of fate, she had promised to marry the bailiff if he could bring the parson to justice. The two men, both prisoners of their circumstances, blamed each other for their predicament, yet they could not help but feel a strange kinship in their shared misery. As the years passed, the parson, confined to the church and unable to perform many of his normal duties, turned his attention to transcribing the scattered parish records into a single bound register. Meanwhile, he and his wife continued to build a family within the sacred walls, welcoming 9 children into the world, all born within the church. Despite their initial scandal, the parson and his wife gradually won the acceptance and forgiveness of the village. In time, the villagers even erected a lean-to structure on the site of the present vestry, providing the family with a modicum of privacy. In 1704, the parson's wife passed away, leaving him to face the harsh winter alone. It was during this frigid season that the parson finally completed his transcription of the parish records, presenting them to the Bishop of Lichfield. On that very day, the coldest in living memory, the bailiff finally managed to arrest the parson, only to drop dead in the midst of his triumphant celebration. 2 years later, the parson himself passed away and was buried next to his beloved wife within the church. The law of the time would have allowed the bailiffs to exhume the bodies and punish them for their unpaid debts, but the Bishop of Lichfield took it upon himself to inter the bodies within the church, ensuring they would rest in peace. The parson's first wife never did marry the bailiff, and she refused to pay for his burial fees. In a final act of irony, the bishop decided to inter the bailiff's body alongside the parson and his wife, so that the three, man, woman, and spurned lover, could be buried together for all eternity. In the end, one might say that the parson and his companions found a unique sort of justice in their shared fate. Their lives, bound together by love, deceit, and stubborn determination, served as a cautionary tale for the people of Eyam. A reminder that life is a complex tapestry of choices and consequences, and that sometimes the most unlikely companions are those who share our deepest burdens.